In this segment, we will talk about how do we do curve fitting by using nonlinear regression, especially the exponential model. So if you look at a typical nonlinear regression model, we'll be given n data points, and we want to be able to best fit a nonlinear curve, which can be any function of x, which will explain the data. Now, the curve which we're going to draw is going to be away from the data points which we have. And what we want to be able to do is to minimize the distance between the data points which are given to us and the regression curve. So for example, if we have xi, y sub phi, which is our data point right here, this is the observed value of y at this particular point, and this will be the predicted value of y at that particular point, the same value of x here, which is x phi. And what we want to be able to do is we want to take this distance right here, which is the observed value minus the predicted value from the regression curve, and we want to make it as small as possible. Typical nonlinear regression models include exponential model, power model, saturation growth model, and polynomials of order 2 or more. Since we are concentrating on the exponential model, so we have n data points, and then we want to best fit it to an exponential model, which is y equal to a e to the power bx. So the y data is given to us as a function of x. So the two constants of the regression model which you have are a and b. So if you look at this particular graph here, we are showing the possible regression curve right here. And then we have these data points which are given to us on this plot. Now, if we take a typical point, xi, y sub I, that is the observed value. And what we're going to get here is the predicted value of y. And the difference between the two is what we call as the residual. The difference between the observed value and the difference and the difference between the observed value and the predicted value. And what do we want to do to them? We want to make these residuals to be as small as possible. So we'll follow the same principles as we applied for the linear regression model to be able to figure out what these constants a and b should be. So we are again following the same principle. We find the sum of the square of the residuals. This is the residual. We square each of the residuals. We add them all up, and that gives us sum of the square of the residuals. Now, what we want to be able to do is we want to minimize this sum of the square of the residuals. And the way to do it is to take the derivative of the residual respect to A and B, which are the constants of the model, and those are the only things which we can change in this particular expression. Y sub i's and x sub i's are fixed. The only thing which we can change is A and B. So how do we take the derivative respect to A? We apply the chain rule. We have, for example, if somebody says, hey, how can you differentiate u square, which is where u is a function of a with respect to a? So that's nothing but 2u du by da. So that's what's happening here. We're taking the derivative of this respect to a, so it'll be 2 times what's here, times the derivative of this inside expression with respect to a, and that turns out to be this. And we'll put that equal to 0. Then the same thing which we do, we apply the same chain rule formula. We take the derivative with respect to b. So again, it'll be 2 times what's inside here, that is this, times the derivative of this quantity with respect to b, which turns out to be this quantity right here. So again, we put that equal to 0. So if we expand the summations from the previous two expressions, we get two equations. And what you're going to find out, hey, these are simply non-linear equations. They are nonlinear equations in terms of a and b. So what you got to figure out here is that we have to find the values of a and b by solving these simultaneous nonlinear equations numerically. We're going to do that in the class itself. So what I'm going to introduce to you here is to look at how can we find the constants of a regression model, nonlinear regression model, such as exponential model, without having to solve nonlinear equations. So one of the ways to do it is to transform the data. Keep in mind that we're not transforming the model. The model is still exponential. What we're doing is transforming the data so that we can use simpler formulas to calculate the constants of a regression model. So let's go through that. So this is our regression model, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to take the natural log of both sides. So if I take the natural log of both sides, I get log of y on the left side. The right side is the form of log of u times v, which will give us log of u plus log of v. So that will be log of a plus log of e to the power bx, and then log of e to the power bx is just bx, so we get this. So how does this help us? If I substitute for log of y, I substitute z. For log of a, I substitute a naught, and for purpose of convenience, I substitute for b, I substitute a1. So if I do that, this becomes z, so that's right here. This becomes a naught, that's right here. And this becomes a1 times x. Now we can easily recognize that this is a linear model. So what you are finding out here is that the z versus x data is correlated linearly. It is not through an exponential model, but keep in mind that this is z versus x is the linear model. And now if we've able to find, we know how to find a0 and a1 for a linear regression model. And once we're able to find a0 and a1, we can find our a back by taking the exponential of a0, because log of a is a0, so that means a is e to the power a0. And we just, for convenience sake, we said a1 is equal to b, which simply means once we find a1, b will be equal to a1. So as we said, that we have now this linear regression model of z versus x. So we already know what the linear regression formulas are, which are very simple. Those are simply some given in some summations as for the linear regression model. And then we find a0. And as I said, that once we find a1, that's the value of b. Once we find a0, a is nothing but e to the power a0. Let's go and illustrate this through an example. One of the simple examples is that whenever people go to a hospital to get their gallbladder or other internal organs scanned, they will take a radioactive dye, and that's what's going to tell them, hey, whether there is something wrong with any of the internal organs. So one of the radioactive dye which is used is made of technetium-99m isotope. Its half-life is about 6 hours. It takes about 24 hours for the radiation levels to go back to whatever we're exposed to in our day-to-day activities. So to keep things simple, what we have done is that we are giving you the relative intensity of radiation as a function of time. Now, when we say relative intensity, the intensity is relative to what it was at time t equals 0. That's when the dye was injected into a particular person. That's why this value is 1. And then you can see the relative intensity is decreasing as time goes by. And we have a model of the relative intensity gamma is equal to a e to the power lambda t, is an exponential model. And so in this case, so what are we trying to find? We're trying to find lambda and we're trying to find a. Those are the two regression constants which we're trying to find for this model. So what we're doing here is simply taking the tabular data which is given to us, showing you it as a plot. The reason why I show it as a plot is so that you get a sense of how your relative intensity varies as a function of time. And if somebody would look at this particular graph intuitively, they might think that relative intensity is almost like a linear function of time, which is not the case. So again, I'm going to go through the theory which we already went through just for the sake of reinforcing what we have found. So we have an exponential of gamma is equal to a to the power lambda t. So gamma versus time is given to us. We'll take the log of both sides, and that gives us this. Once we take the log of both sides, we assume this is z. A naught is log of a, which is this one. And for the sake of convenience, we say a1 is equal to lambda. What do we get is z is equal to a0 plus a1t. And that's a linear relationship between z and t, which is given here. Keep in mind the relationship is linear between z and t. The relationship between gamma and time is still exponential. That hasn't changed. So we have a linear regression model right here. Z is equal to a0 plus a1t. From our linear regression models, we know what the values of a1 and a0 are. So bottom line is that we have to find these 1, 2, 3, 4 different summations to be able to find out what a1 is. And then from those summations, we can also then find a0, because this is nothing, the average value of z, and t bar is nothing but the average value of the time data which is given to us. So here is the data which is given to us. So we have 6 data points. So that's what I'm showing you here. These are the times which are given to us. These are the relative radiation intensity which is given to us. Now keep in mind that in order to use the linear regression formulas, we have to take the log of the gamma values, and that's what we are doing here. And then we have to find ti times zi, and then we have to find ti squared so that we can find those summations. So the summation of the time value is 25. We don't find the summations of the gamma values, which is a big mistake that students make, because they find the summations of gamma quantity rather than the z quantity. So we are finding the summations of the z quantity, the summation of ti times zi, and the summations of ti squared. So because those are the summations which are in our formulas for a1 and a0. So the summations have been, so we have 6 data points. The summations are being placed right here to show them to you separately, which are coming from these tabular values here. And what we're going to do is now is to simply take these summations and substitute them into these formulas for a1 and a0, and we'll be able to get numbers for our two constants a0 and a1 of the z versus time data. So this is what we get by making the substitutions. We get a1 equal to minus 0.11505. To find z bar, we take the average of the z value, summation of z values, and then we take the average of the t values, time values, which are given to us. That gives us t bar, and that gives us the value of a0 to be equal to this quantity right here. So since we know that a0 is log of a, that's the substitution which we made in order to convert our exponential model to a linear regression model. A will be nothing but e to the power a0. So that turns out to be e to the power a0, which we just found out, and gives us 0.99974. Lambda is same as a1. We just substituted a1 for lambda just for convenience sake. So that turns out to be minus 0.11505. So in fact, we have found out the constants of the regression model. So this is a, and this is lambda. So the resulting model will be this: gamma is equal to a e to the power lambda t. So a e to the power lambda t, a is this quantity and lambda is this quantity, and that's how we're able to write what the resultant model is. We have also plotted the data points and the curve for sake of convenience, and this is how it looks like. So it looks like, visually it looks like that it's a good fit, but as we're going to talk about later, that just visualizing the data is not enough to figure out whether a particular regression model is a good fit. And that's the end of this segment.